All right. Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for coming. Let me quickly introduce ourselves. This is Vivek, and I'm Aniket. We are part of Juniper Networks. We are representing the Contrail team at Juniper Networks. Vivek is a cloud solutions architect, and
Hi.
I'm a product manager.
Hi, everyone.
So the Contrail product is based on an open source project called Tungsten Fabric. Tungsten Fabric was a recent name. The original project was called Open Contrail and was rechristened to Tungsten Fabric. So this presentation is not necessarily about Tungsten Fabric or about Contrail. It's to discuss to overlay or not to overlay. And since you're here, I'm guessing you guys have brooded over this question and given it some amount of consideration yourselves. So we're going to try and look at all the different aspects to this question and see if we can come up with some sort of an answer to this question. So to begin with, all of us are here because we have, in some sense, a common frenemy, public clouds. Are public clouds the modern day manifestation of vendor lock-in? You know, a few years back, if you talk about classical network equipment and network equipment vendors like Cisco and Juniper, if they said their BGP implementations didn't interoperate, no customer would tolerate that. The implementations had to interoperate. Is that true of the public clouds today? And the answer is no. And you could give the public clouds different names. It's a one-way street into the public cloud. It's a Hotel California. You can check in, nobody can check out. And some people have even ventured so far as to call them cloud jails. Now, remember that it may appear when you start off, it may appear to be cheaper to rent, but being a renter eventually ends up being super expensive. And there's always opportunities of cost arbitrage across public clouds. There may be times when one public cloud is cheaper than the others, and you know, within days or even hours, that the economics may change. And therefore, you always, as a customer, you always want to be able to leverage all the different public clouds, not be tied in, not be locked into one public cloud. Now, with that said, it does not imply that private clouds are nirvana either. And remember that while we are doing this presentation, we're going to focus on the networking portion of the challenge. And our basic hypothesis is that in modern day environments where you have multi-cloud, hybrid cloud environments, you need a common substrate across all of these environments. Vivek, would you?
Yeah, so just one thing what I wanted to add to what Aniket mentioned just now is that so networking is the most critical piece when we talk about you know, any cloud kind of environment, because you know, if you talk about compute or storage, you know, there are like ways to, you know, you can migrate, say, from a public cloud or to a private cloud, or you know, basically from one cloud to other cloud, right? You can snapshot, you can like take files, but networking is the thing. It's not like object that is at rest, right? So it is something that kind of connects everything. So that kind of becomes the most critical piece, right? So, and that's why, you know, it's very important to, you know, like put a lot of thought into it, right? When we are designing, you know, a cloud environment.
Absolutely. Absolutely, well said. So what I'd recommend, there's a URL at the bottom of this slide. That URL is basically an article written by Avi Friedman. Now, Avi Friedman currently is the co-founder CEO of this company called Kentik. They make monitoring software, but he's in his past life been, he's run an ISP in Philadelphia. He's also been the network chief network scientist at Akamai and therefore run the network for a CDN. And he's written an article that's interestingly titled, Three Infrastructure Mistakes Your Company Must Not Make. And he's making some of these arguments. Since we've discussed that, I just highly recommend you read that article. It's a very nicely written article. Now, with that said, what we are trying to say, what we alluded to in the previous slide, is that a common substrate is our hypothesis, that across all these environments, what you need is a least common denominator, and that least common denominator is a common substrate that extends, that is available across all environments. And you know, we've proven the value of virtualization. We've proven the value of virtualization on compute, on storage, and therefore it's the case for network virtualization does not necessarily need to be made. It's very apparent that there's a strong need for network virtualization. If you look at public clouds, there's native networking provided by the public cloud providers. Each public cloud provider has their own set of features, and therefore there does not exist a feature parity even across different public cloud providers. There's for reasons of cost economics, et cetera, there's always a reason to interconnect across different public clouds and also interconnect between on-prem and public clouds. Then if you come to the private clouds, you have to deal with physical network infrastructure. Your API to the physical network infrastructure are the network administrators. And the way physical networking and network administrators have dealt with cloud scale in on-prem environments is by using Ansible or Puppet-driven automation of configuration of the network devices. Now, aside from just the considerations that are specific to the public and private clouds themselves, you need end-to-end visibility. You need to be able to seamlessly connect or stretch network segments across cloud boundaries. And finally, what you need is consistent primitives for both networking and security across all cloud boundaries.
Yeah, well, again, I want to make an analogy here. A very good comparison or analogy to this is, again, service providers. So in the case of internet service providers also, you have, like multiple tier 1, tier 1, tier 2 ISPs. They use different kind of devices from different vendors, but they talk this common protocol called as BGP, right? So BGP is the one, everybody needs to talk. They have, all the vendors they need to interop. But in the case of the cloud providers, right, there is no such well-defined standard. It kind of becomes now it's on the user to kind of define that end-to-end connectivity, right? The cloud provider is not going to, for them, the boundary ends on their gateways. So it's the user who has to kind of take care of that, having that end-to-end connectivity. So there is no well-defined standard, when I want to connect multiple cloud providers, so what are the protocols or the rules for connectivity?
Some cloud providers provide software that allow you to mimic the stack that's running in their public cloud environment. They provide you software that can be mimicked and run in on-prem environments. But that doesn't solve the multi-cloud problem, right? You can run that on-prem. What about running it in other clouds? So like he said, that problem is unsolved. So what, therefore, is network virtualization? Why don't we, for a second, just look at the definition of network virtualization? Now, network virtualization is basically within any cloud or virtualized data center. Network virtualization is the ability, is being able to give each tenant the illusion that they have a logically separated network isolated from all the other tenants just for themselves. And now when you talk of a public cloud, who's a tenant? A tenant of the public cloud is a customer of that cloud. And if you talk of a private cloud, a tenant corresponds to some department of that larger organization. And just like virtual machines sit on top of physical machines and they are abstracting the vagaries of the underlying environment, virtual networks sit on top of physical networks, and they are in that sense very similar to virtual machines. Now, these virtual networks may be L2 segments, L3 segments, or maybe more complicated networks, multiple L2, L3 segments interconnected by policies. And so that's what network virtualization is. Now, what are some of the considerations? When you talk of private cloud, what are some of the considerations that a network virtualization solution needs to be able to address?
Yeah, so the first one is secure tenant isolation, right? So basically, every user or every department, or basically what is called as a tenant, so they need to have their own logical topology, right, where if they have virtual machines or containers, so they should be freely able to talk to each other. And by default, there should not be any cross-talk between the tenants. So that's what the word secure means. And one can connect them together, but in a very controlled way, right? Where you can apply some policies to define what kind of traffic that can flow between the tenants or what you should block. The second thing is decouple the tenant topology from a physical network topology. This is like very important, even for the administrator or the cloud provider. When I say cloud provider, in this case, say the private cloud provider, that I when I'm launching a virtual machine or a container, I should not be constrained that I should only launch it, on this rack and on this server, because the way my networking is set up, it kind of forces me to, launch on that segment, right? So basically, there has to be a decoupling. So you need to have an underlay topology should be separate from overlay topology, right? So you should be able to launch a virtual machine on any server, on any rack. And if there are resource constraints, I should be able to move it to some other corner of the data center. And you should still have that.
You should also be able to make changes in the physical infrastructure, in the physical network infrastructure, without worrying exactly about how it impacts the tenants.
The next one is addressing. So this is very important because the users, they should be free to use the way they want to use the IP addresses. So basically, there has to be a way where overlapping addresses can be used between tenants, right? And also, just to add, to what Aniket mentioned, so the addressing of the overlay or the tenant addressing, I don't want to say overlay, we have not come to that point, but the addressing the tenant uses has to be independent from the addressing that is used in the underlay.
That's right.
Right, and this is applicable both for IPv4 and IPv6. And the next one is external connectivity. So typically in a data center, when you have virtual networks where you have a lot of tenants and users, so they will be typically using private RFC 1918 addresses, the private address space. So whenever they want to talk to the public internet, the connectivity may be from inside to outside or from outside to inside. There has to be a way to achieve that, right? Mm-hmm. So OpenStack, so we have things like floating IP and SNAT. So that is the other consideration. And then the integration with legacy networks. So you can have workloads which may not be, it is not easy to virtualize them. Things like mainframes or some legacy databases. So they will be still running in the bare metal form factor. So how do you provide connectivity, with the new virtualized workloads to the legacy workload? And finally, the underlay network design consideration itself. So to support all the, all the above mentioned the features, so how I should design my underlay, right? I don't want to make it very expensive, right? It has to be it should be cost effective. It should be easy to manage, troubleshoot, and operate. So multicast, we thought we should add this because I think this is one of the somewhat overlooked features, but I think it is very important, especially when it comes to financial customers, where you have a lot of application that uses multicast. Yeah. So what is the efficient way to kind of transport multicast streams, right? In your tenant context,
yes,
right? And finally, the scale and performance, right? You should be, it should be designed in such a way that, keeping future in mind, right? I should be able to add more and more tenants, users, and, also workloads.
There are different kinds of workloads. You may want to run some network functions, and for network functions, packets per second may be important. Some workloads may want to leverage data plane acceleration technologies like DPDK. Some workloads may want to leverage technologies like smart network interface cards. Some may want to leverage some kind of offloads that the NICs provide. So all of those are considerations that we need to keep in mind for a solution. Now, speaking of public clouds, one of the main reasons for using public clouds is to account for the unpredictable demand and therefore the cloud bursting scenarios. So any solution that we think of should be able to address that cloud burst scenario and be able to provide an efficient way to accomplish cloud bursting when the need arises. And therefore, on demand, your network should be able to extend when there is a need. And that extended network should provide that on-ramp to move workloads where they need to be moved, and then move them back when the need is completed. The aspect of external internet connectivity was covered in the previous slide for private clouds. That need exists even in the public clouds as well. In the public clouds, each public cloud provides a lot of native services. For example, just one example, in the case of Amazon, they have a storage service in the form of S3. So there may be a need for, when you are using that public cloud, there may be a need to use those native public cloud services, which in that sense are running in that public cloud's underlay. So we need to...
Just to add to this point what Aniket mentioned. So if you take the case of Amazon, so they have like services like S3 and the Redshift, the one of the database services, and I think there is one more, where you can create endpoints and you can access it using the Amazon's internal network. So you may ask, fine, that is good, but what is the problem if I go through the internet and then access, right? Because S3 is something that has a global endpoint. But you know, as a network architect, technology is one thing, but also you have to also keep an eye on the cost. If you notice, Amazon charges different price if you use the internet versus if you use their internal network. So the price they charge per bandwidth, so it is like different. They charge more if you would like transit the internet. It doesn't matter if you want to use their service or if you want to use some other service that is out there on the internet.
So we should be able to connect to these native public cloud services without doing these kind of tromboning, which will affect performance, but also your cost optimizations. Now, whenever there is a public cloud, we imagine that there is also an on-prem equivalent, because hybrid cloud is a reality. There's few customers who are also just pure public cloud environments, but a majority of organizations have what is called the hybrid cloud, and therefore there needs to be a secure way of connecting back to the on-prem environments, and therefore an equally efficient way of securely repatriating workloads. When the cost economics change, when the unpredictable demand has subsided, you need a way to repatriate workloads back to your on-prem environments. And finally, the point of consistency continues. Even for those organizations who in the present tense are 100% in the public cloud, they need to be future-proof and be able to move workloads to other clouds or back to on-prem when cost economics when it is not cost prohibitive for them to run workloads on-prem.
I think the bottom line should be, as a network administrator, I should be able to imagine a public cloud as just another availability zone, right? I should be my on-prem is availability zone, my public cloud is availability zone. So it should be seamless, right? If I say AZ as on-prem, just you launch that workload on on-prem.
Absolutely.
Right? If I give AZ public cloud, and then we should be able to move around. Right? I think that's what the repatriation, the word means.
Yeah. Absolutely. So then, given all these considerations, given all those challenges, what are the different approaches? There many solutions exist. So what are some of the approaches? So one of the classical approaches I know is, the question we may ask is, oh, network virtualization, we've been virtualizing networks for ages now, VLANs, virtual local area networks. But the problem with VLANs is that they are fundamentally an on-prem technology, fundamentally tied to physical network equipment. Somebody has to actually go and make that configuration in different top of rack devices, configure, and VLANs correspond to tenant state, and that tenant state now has to be configured in every top of rack box. When a tenant goes away, in cloud environments, tenants are pretty dynamic. They may come, bring in their workloads, go away at some point later. So that tenant state in the form of VLANs has to be constantly configured and then unconfigured, and you're constantly making a lot of churn on your physical network equipment. Further, VLANs are limited to 4,095 and so on. So there's a slew of limitations with that.
Basically, the VLAN, it actually violates the first rule we mentioned in the previous slide, decoupling of the physical and the tenant topology. There is a very tight coupling here.
Absolutely. Right. Now, there are native cloud networking approaches, for example, VPC networking in the case of AWS. But the problem is they are confined to those environments. You can't use them in other environments. then you come to some modern approaches.
Yeah. So just to add to what Aniket mentioned, so basically with the for the cloud provider, if you are using features from the from the VPC in the case of AWS and I think Google, I think calls it virtual network. So basically, you are at the mercy of the cloud provider if you want, say, new features, right? I mean, you have to dependent on them, and they may be rolling out these features, but at their timeline, right?
Yep.
So it may impact your business. Coming to the modern approaches, the controllerless technology. So this is where the word the SDN kind of. I'm sorry. The first one, controllerless. So there are ways where without using a SDN controller, I can still achieve like overlays. So one very good example for this is like if I want to have a layer 2 overlays, I can use EVP and VXLAN. It still kind of uses VXLAN as an encapsulation. Typically, the use case for this is like where I have a predominantly a bare metal kind of environment. I can use this, and it kind of makes like very simple. And most of the vendors these days, they kind of support EVPN as the control plane for VXLAN encapsulation. And in the non-overlay case, we have a Neutron, which basically it is a Neutron is a, like it's a controller which is kind of managing the open vSwitch on individual compute nodes, but it kind of still uses VLAN. So you have all the limitation that exists with the VLAN, which is mentioned above. It even exists in this case. Then we have the non-overlay or the routed mode. Basically, when we talk about overlay or the non-overlay, we are going to explain in the next slide. You can think like overlay is basically you are tunneling packets between two servers or two switches. So overlay can exist between servers, or it can exist between two switches, or it can even exist between a server and a switch based on the what kind of connectivity you want. The non-overlay routed mode basically it's you are treating the workloads like any other routing endpoints in your network. So you are not going to use any tunneling between devices. The devices, the routers or the switches in your network, they need to be aware of all the host IP addresses that are in your network. The overlay, the Neutron OVS, it is like the same Neutron controller that is programming the open vSwitches on the compute nodes, but in this case, you can use either VXLAN or GRE as encapsulation. And then you have these overlay encapsulation technologies. They can be used with the other SDN controllers from other vendors, where you can have more sophisticated features, right? And we have kind of mentioned some of the vendors.
Now, the problem is that these are all either purely non-overlay or they are purely overlay. But the question is, all of these have some pros and some cons. So is there some alternative approach that's really a hybrid approach that combines the best of both worlds? We'll talk about that. Let's look at some of these overlay options.
Yeah, so first. I just wanted to give a quick overview. I don't want to kind of spend too much time on this. So these are some of the, I have listed some of the popularly, commonly used overlay techniques. Basically, this kind of shows the data plane frame format. For the control plane, as I said, you have like various SDN controllers, and I also mentioned about the controllerless-based approach. So the first one is a NVGRE. So GRE kind of existed on routers and switches for a long time to create, IP tunnels between devices. So NVGRE, it kind of extends that. So the pure GRE is a way to encapsulate a layer 3 packet inside another layer 3 packet. NVGRE, it kind of extends that. Now you can encapsulate a layer 2 payload in a layer 3 header. So as you can see, the outer, there is outer IP header followed by that. You have the NVGRE header itself, which has a field called as a virtual subnet identifier. That is the 24-bit field which you can use to identify to which tenant network the packet belongs. And then you have the inner Ethernet frame.
So each of these frame formats have their pros and cons.
MPLS over UDP, that is something interesting. So that is one of the encapsulation formats which is implemented in the tungsten fabric or in the contrail. In the case of the GRE, VXLAN, and even in the case of STT, the the identifier, right? They have different names, vSID, VNID, and so on. So they are specific to the tenant or to the virtual network. So all the workloads in that virtual network, so they use that a single identifier, which actually means is that when you receive a frame, you strip the outer header, and then you need to do a lookup in the the tenant bridge table, right? Because the ID only points to the bridge table, but you need to still find out to which VM or which container you need to send packet.
In other words, when packet arrives at the destination, a second lookup needs to be performed in order to get to its ultimate destination.
With MPLS, the label has a local significance. It's not global. So basically, I can allocate a label for every virtual machine. So basically, just looking at the label, I can directly send it to a, that endpoint. That kind of saves you on the, the lookup time, which actually enhances your performance. But the most interesting thing that happens here is that now I can manipulate the label. By changing the label, instead of sending the packet directly to the workload, I can send it to some other, intermediate virtual machine. And that intermediate, machine can be a firewall. And that's how I can actually achieve service chaining, right? When two VMs want to communicate, instead of directly sending from VM A to B, I can send it to, say, firewall one, followed by that, I can send to, say, another, like a DPI device, right, to a load balancer.
So you can, in an abstract fashion, define these policies of how traffic should be routed, and you can use these MPLS labels to get that sequence actually done.
So STT is very similar to NVGRE and VXLAN. The only reason I added here is that when this was basically NICE era, like implemented this on NSX. So the reason they implemented this was that there were already capabilities existed on the NICs to do a TCP offload, like segmentation and checksum. That's why it uses a TCP header. All the other protocols they use, like either UDP. So now the modern NICs, they even support VXLAN. You can offload VXLAN related operations to the NIC. So STT is not very prominently used, and IPsec, it is mentioned here because there is like lot of importance it's very important to now secure connectivity due to various reasons like compliance, and that's why we have IPsec. So you can actually put a authentication IPsec encryption and authentication header that kind of surrounds the one of the above mentioned encapsulation. So it kind of becomes an encapsulation inside encapsulation.
So we have 10 minutes remaining. So we want to save time for the demo that actually shows you the main point we want to make. So let's quickly get to the point we want to make. So overlays are great, but you have to pay the encapsulation tax because the actual packet is actually now encapsulated in some more headers. So you are paying some encapsulation tax. You are incurring some performance overhead. You need gateways in order to be able to exit the overlay and get to the services running in the underlay or exit the premises, connect to the internet. So there are some limitations even with using overlays. Therefore, the point we want to make is there's no silver bullet. There's pros and cons of using both overlays as well as using non-overlay based approaches. One size doesn't fit all. So ideally, based on the use case, we want to be able to leverage an overlay-based approach where it is appropriate and a non-overlay-based approach where it is expensive to use an overlay. And we also want the ability to have the coexistence of different overlay types because, as you saw in the prior slide, there's pros and cons of even different overlay technologies themselves. At the same time, we want them to coexist alongside a non-overlay option.
Yeah, basically, is there a way for them to coexist, right? And with that, we can actually go to our demo, right?
Yeah, so the idea is, are we kind of dreaming? Is it real? Show us the proof.
Yeah, so I know this is the OpenStack Summit, but we actually put Kubernetes because we are using Amazon. This even works, in the on-prem case, we have this working with OpenStack. So what you see here is that I have a VPC, I have two subnets. I have a Kubernetes master that is, running on the first subnet 10.10.10/24. I have like two nodes in each subnet. So what I'm basically going to do is that I'm going to launch a pod. I'm going to create two virtual networks. So this is using Contrail as the Contrail/Tungsten Fabric as the SDN controller. I'm going to create two virtual networks for two tenants. One is going to be overlay, and one is going to be using the non-overlay approach. So it is actually the non-overlay routed mode. And then
question is, why do you need a non-overlay mode?
Yes. So some of the things what we can do now is that if I want to reach the internet from the node or from the container, basically, I don't need an internet gateway, right? Otherwise, if you are using overlay, you need to kind of go through a gateway to go from the overlay to the underlay and then going to the internet. And the second use case, what we want to demonstrate is what we mentioned, the endpoints. We are actually going to create an endpoint, and we can see that we can kind of access that file directly from the from the container. And because we are not going to use any overlay, we don't have to go through the gateway. So we can use actually Amazon's internal infrastructure to directly get that resource. And finally, so I have a container that is in the overlay network and the container that is in the underlay network. So do we have multi-tenancy, right? So can they talk by
isolation?
Right. So there has to be isolation, like what we mentioned in our slide. And then how do you connect them, right? I want to connect them by applying some policies. So that is the, the demo, what we are going to show next.
So let's switch to the demo. So this, what you're seeing, is basically the Contrail dashboard. Now, on the Contrail dashboard, we are showing you that there are two vRouters running. You can call them the vRouter, or you can call them an FER node. FER stands for Forwarding, Enforcement, and Reporting. Those nodes are running on the EC2 instances that you saw in the prior slide. And these are the two EC2 instances. They have these IP addresses.
And they come from different VPC subnets, if you notice there, from the 10 and the 20 subnet, right?
So then we quickly go to the EC2 management console, the AWS dashboard.
So basically, these are the nodes and the IPs, they have, just to kind of cross-check.
Just mapping to the prior slide, there is the Kubernetes master, where the Contrail controller is running, and then there are two minions, or Kubernetes nodes. That's what you're seeing here. Now, what we are going to do?
One thing you can notice that is that the Contrail, all the Contrail controller-related components, they themselves are running as a Kubernetes pod. If you just kind of scroll, but that's okay. So what we are going to do here is that if you see the contents of the two YAML files, so these are the two Kubernetes manifests for creating two pods, and we are using a custom annotation. If you can highlight. Yeah. So we are using this custom annotation for, which is kind of specific to Contrail, where it is now possible to launch pods in any given network. So by default in Kubernetes, you can only launch containers in the pod network, but using this feature, you can launch, container in a specific virtual network that could be, it could be on different projects.
So those, based on those YAML files, we launch those pods in two separate virtual networks.
And these are the networks what are, the mentioned in the YAML file. So there is one overlay virtual network, which is using the 172 subnet. So this is not from the VPC address space. So that's why it's overlay. And then we have created IPAM that kind of uses the last 128 IP address from that 10.10.10 subnet. So we have the two networks. One is for overlay and one for the non-overlay. And the annotation, actually, the two YAMLs, they kind of point to each one of these virtual networks. So you can see the VPC private subnet VN. You can see the subnet there mentioned is 10.10.10.128/25, which kind of, it's the last 128, the second half of that VPC subnet. So we launch, both these pods, right? And if we see the output of kubectl get pods, we can see that the pods are up. They are like running on each of those nodes. And if you see the IP address, you can see that the one pod has got the IP address from the underlay. So it is nothing but the Amazon's VPC IP address, right? It's one of the IP address from the VPC subnet. And the second pod that has the IP address from overlay network, which is 172.31.0.3, right? So now we can quickly go to the pod that is actually running in the non-overlay mode, right? And if we, you know, we check the IP address. And what we can do next is that if we ping basically 8888 Google's DNS server, and at the bottom, we are actually running TCP dump on the EC2 instance where that pod is running. So this is like the compute node. This is a Kubernetes node where that pod is running. And you can see that the TCP dump output shows that there is no encapsulation being used. It is like a native IPv4 packet where the source is the pod's IP 10.10.10.131, and the destination address is the, you know, the Google's DNS IP address.
So now what we are going to show is connecting to the S3 service.
Yes. So the next what I can do is that I have like just edited the DNS file on the on that server. Now from the pod, I can get that S3 file. And you can see the TCP dump output shown here. Again, there is no encapsulation, right? And finally, if you can pause. Now I'm pinging 172.31.0.3. So I'm basically trying to communicate from a pod that is running in the non-overlay network to the pod that is running in the overlay network, right? So basically communication across two networks. And as expected, it is not permitted here because, you know, the contrail by default, a virtual network is a closed group of users. So within a virtual network, you can communicate freely, and across virtual networks, you cannot. And that's why we apply this network policy, which is a construct to connect multiple virtual networks, right? And once we do that, now if, so we have to basically, the policy is already created. So policy is a basically a way where you can mention, I want to connect two virtual networks and what type of traffic I want to permit, right? It's a firewall plus connectivity.
So as soon as that policy is applied, you can see that the ping packets are now making it from the non-overlay pod to the overlay pod. And the ping to that 172 address is now going through. And then when you actually do the TCP dump.
And if we can pause. If you observe the TCP dump now you don't see the IP address of the container there. The source and the destination IP address, they are the two EC2 node IP addresses. Basically, what this means is that this is an encapsulated packet. Actually, the port 6635, that is the UDP destination port for MPLS over UDP. So in this case, the packet is actually getting encapsulated, over MPLS over UDP. So basically, what this means is that the vRouter or the controller, it is kind of dynamically, it's able to determine basically based on what type of traffic it is. If a non-overlay pod wants to talk to internet, it is sent as a native traffic. If a overlay pod wants to talk to the internet, it will be sent as overlay, but then you need a gateway. Overlay can talk to a non-overlay, right, using encapsulation. So, you want to add?
Yeah, so like we said, our hypothesis is that across all of the environments, you need a common substrate. Overlays are a good way to provide that common substrate. So you get the same set of primitives, same set of functionality across all your environments. You don't lock yourself to any particular environment. And then there are different considerations between different overlay technologies. So, and there are some costs or penalties to using the overlays, and therefore you want the option to use a non-overlay approach. So you want a solution that combines the best of both worlds, and there are some...
And then just want to add quickly before we end. So there are more other cool features possible with this. We have not covered in the demo, but it's definitely something that is possible. You can do something like a distributed NAT now. You can have a compute node acting as a SNAT gateway for its local, the workloads. You don't have to go through like Tromon through a centralized node to do a SNAT. Plus the other cool feature is that in this case, we see that a overlay workload can talk to a non-overlay workload. Now I can make that non-overlay workload or the non-overlay endpoint as the host compute node's host interface itself. So I can run some application on the compute node host, like I can run a Git repo on the host. Now it is possible for the virtual machines or the containers to access that.
Absolutely. So best of both worlds. Some solutions provide that. Be wise when you make your choice. Thank you.
Thanks.